We're going to take a few minutes to wrap up our combined discussion. I'm so pleased that so many of you could find it in your schedules to come out to extra classes. And for those of you who came in late, looking surprised, remember, these were students from all of my classes who wanted to have independent study. Now keep in mind also that the maintenance of the lawn for the institution has started back up, so you may hear a lot of background noise with respect to that. But what we want to wrap up with today, because many of you have been asking to hear from me, and I've spent quite a bit of time hearing from you and facilitating your discussions, which have been wonderful, by the way. It's always, always better when the students speak more than the professors do, in my opinion. So I told the students that I would speak a little bit about history, specifically the subject of radical history. So I thought this morning about hope and struggle and history and the idea of prophets. And this thought that came to me was that I believe that occasionally historians are prophets. Now, some of my students would agree that historians hide inside of mythological grottos for months and years at a time, and when they emerge, they do so with cryptic books and articles that in some way, shape, or form predict the future. The prophets of history also do unexpected things. For example, there seems to be a considerable resurgence in scholarly historical studies on triumphal and radical history. And this has been on my mind quite a bit, but particularly we had a guest speaker here, Dr. Sharon Harley, an eminent scholar in her own right. And she talked quite a bit about the notion of radical history. So when we discuss this, I'm thinking about the upsurge in interest, especially by so-called mainstream scholars and their rising stars and students. They surface despite the fact that radical historians have existed long before our understanding of what that means to us. And I'm thinking specifically in African American history and culture. So radical historians have existed long before Carter G. Woodson and J.A. Rogers. We know that historians and other scholars of the past choose their research agenda based on many factors. This includes, of course, personal factors, professional training, their experiences, their interests, their plans, and especially their own sense of social commitment, which some people might interpret as civic involvement. And I also want to mention that when we speak about radical historians, most of the time people are referring to socialist and communist historians, those scholars who are either immersed in that ideology personally, or they utilize that ideology in their research and scholarship. But we're going to move away from that just a little bit, because I want us to consider the idea of radical history and the idea that it's fashionable for scholars today to research and write about it, but that they ultimately contribute to a larger discourse of theory and praxis is of no doubt. And in doing so, they unearth the oppressed as formidable and recognizable agents in history. Now, this is why during the Civil Rights Movement, Black Power Movement, when Malcolm X called upon the United Nations to address the past and at that time current repression against African Americans, he was thought of as uniquely courageous and insightful. However, Marcus Garvey and others had, long before Malcolm X, addressed the world community on behalf of Blacks. On the wide spectrum of radical history, we should note that varieties of historians are often accused of romanticizing the oppressed or punitively vilifying them, suggesting that the image will reveal many important things about the people in history, especially those people thought to be powerless. These insights include the use of potent organizational strategies and patterns of behavior, the safeguarding of cultural and political memories, and a deeply embedded connection to a victorious ideal. This means that the oppressed in history always have power, whether it is nascent or actualized. Even the most staid chroniclers of history cannot dismiss how knowledge of the past engenders hope for the future. I also want you to consider that the children of past conquerors may cheer for the status quo, but the children of the oppressed constantly rise. Never truly prepared to relinquish their birthright of struggle. This is why, from the beginning of Europe's Atlantic enterprise involving enslaved African people, an act designed to increase labor, wealth, and state power, slavery existed alongside the resistance and rebellion of Africans. Today, those who reject the view that it is the end of man, woman, essentially they're saying the end of history, and even the idea of the end of progress, cannot deny that for every person, history can be summed up as the struggle of people. This includes the struggle of the Brujeria, African and Native American women in colonial Latin America who challenged Spanish domination through quote unquote witchcraft. And why on July 14th in 1899, Kelly Miller openly challenged truncated conceptualizations of Africans as appendages to other nations of peoples. And those students who are here from my Blacks in the Cities class, you'll remember our readings on Kelly Miller. Now, let me go on to say that studying history is the struggle to critically understand, uncover, interpret, and to share information. Yet what happens when we recognize that we are actually living in momentous historical times, periods when history appears to take on an atypical, collective, heightened sense of significance? In these moments, we are often visited by our prophets of history. Or it may be that once again, we can't see the forest for the trees. Now, clever people don't need history at all because the past is massive and obvious, literally an overwhelming and imperceptible forest. While others feel that humans need history more than anything else, and these folks will essentially unwittingly become militants of history and historical knowledge, seeking to preserve transformative ideas already known by oppressed people. And that is that to be truly human in this day and age is to possess clarity of the past. Even the oppressed are powerful because of their attention to history, their ability to build internal and external environments of freedom, because of their ability, and I mean against all odds, to liberate themselves. It appears that more historians are embracing radical history, not just the long-distance runners of radical history from, you know, various disciplines, and that this tells us that the whole concept or the whole idea is worth paying attention to.